Well, the question this morning on the table is, why witness? Why should we do this? If you'll turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 1, verse 8, I want you to hold that verse. We're going to get to it, but we have several we're going through before that to answer the question, why witness? A witness generally refers to something or someone that bears testimony to the thing seen or heard or transacted or experienced. A witness may refer to a person who is firmly convinced by faith and would willingly die for that faith. In the book of Luke, witness is used in an active evangelistic sense. It is not in any way passive. Christians proclaim the gospel in an active, persistent way, encouraging listeners to receive and respond to the message. Some claim they don't share their faith with others because they simply live it before them. Others never consider the act of witnessing to someone at all. So this morning I want to address the question, why should we witness? Why is it important that we share our faith? Well, the Bible gives us several reasons to consider. The first one is that we should be anxious to share our faith with others because it's a wonderful privilege. It's a privilege to be able to do this. In Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7, it says there, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns." Well, one reason we should tell others that Christ, what Christ has done for us is because God says it's a beautiful thing for us to do. I'm going to tell you, I can attest to that. You, if you were with us this week, you can attest to that, that being able to talk to somebody, to share something as simple as five little symbols on a t-shirt, it brought joy into our life. We got excited. And you know, as Beth, I appreciate you mentioning that. With those symbols on that t-shirt or on that wristband that you're wearing, you don't have to go knock on somebody's door and say, "Can I tell you about Jesus?" All you have to do is show them with that t-shirt, those five symbols. And as one person said, "I read the back of your t-shirt and I understand that. Grace Chapel, Connect, Grow, Serve. But what does that mean on the front?" One person thought it was Italian. Somebody else thought it was Indian symbols. But you know, they asked the question. You didn't have to introduce it. They are curious. And so it gives us opportunity and a blessing to be able to share what Christ has done. When you witness to others, you bring the good news of the gospel to them. You proclaim the peace of Jesus Christ that you have in your life and that they can have. You proclaim salvation, that there is no other way under heaven but the name of Jesus by which someone can be saved. You announce that God reigns not only in Jerusalem, in Zion, but he reigns in your life. It really is a privilege to share what God has done. Another reason it's important to witness is that God's message is accomplishes what he desires. Isaiah 55, in that same book, the prophet Isaiah wrote in 55:11, "My word goes out from my mouth and will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." You know, beginning in Genesis, as we're studying in our Bible study at 9:30 on Sunday mornings, for those of you who haven't quite made it there yet, we pray you will. Beginning in Genesis, we see that whatever God speaks comes into being, even when it doesn't exist. That's certainly good news for us. Let me tell you why. It means that what God wants for us, he can speak into being. Do you realize that? God wants blessing for you today. He can speak that into being. It can be not happening, and yet God desires it to happen in your life, and he causes it to happen. Furthermore, he can speak things away from us as well, things that would harm us. So knowing God's word accomplishes what God wants means that means that as we share his word, he will supernaturally cause things to happen. Have you thought about that? God loves you. He is always with you. He is with you in the presence of the Holy Spirit. He lives inside of every believer. And that means that as we walk through this world and God desires something in his heart to come to pass, that all he has to do is will it into being. Now, you know, we were talking in our Sunday school class this morning about God blessing us. But, you know, our faith is tested, isn't it? God tests your faith. And I don't know of any test that God has ever given me to test my faith that has been a positive light in my life. Because usually when God tests your faith, it's with something that we consider negative. It could be something financial. It could be something in a way of health. It could be something in the way of our family members. But God tests our faith regularly. Let me tell you something. Did you ever think about this? God already knows whether you're going to pass the test or not. He already knows. So why is he giving us the test? He already knows the outcome. Well, it's for our sakes, isn't it? So that we will know whether we can pass the test or not. God allows something to come into your life, and it's a negative, and you're thinking, oh, God, help me here. You know, sometimes people get tested with their faith, and they turn to their own resources. Wrong. They turn to their own abilities or talents. Wrong. You fail the test when you do that. When God allows you to be tested, he is testing your faith to see if you will turn to him, trust him, believe him to bring you through it. And I can attest to this test, that God has always brought me through it when I trust him to do it. So as we look and understand that God's message of the gospel, God's word will never return void, but will always accomplish what he sets it out to do. I want you to know that when you open your mouth in a restaurant this afternoon, when you go eat, or at somebody's house, maybe it's at your house and you're having family over for dinner, or maybe this afternoon you're going to meet with some people that you know, and you have your wristband on, and you do this, and you tell them what those symbols mean, it doesn't fall on deaf ears. Now, when Marilyn and I were at the ER in the wee hours of the morning that day, that night, whatever you want to call it, and she shared the gospel with that doctor, we could see by the time she got to the second symbol of the cross and she told him what that meant, he just shut down. He was not interested. And Marilyn kept right on going, just like he was eating up every word. Because her words did not fall on deaf ears, but fell on a nurse. I remember a time when, years ago, when God had me stop through Memphis on the way. I was on a trip I had won in the insurance business. I was on my way to Arkansas to play golf. And I said, well, since I'm going that way and I have people that I used to know real well and work with in the Army and recruiting in Memphis, I said, I'm going to go through Memphis and I'm going to talk to a guy, a recruiter, that was a good buddy of mine, but he was lost as a duck. In fact, he was into witches and that kind of stuff, just the opposite of worshiping God. And I said, I'm going to take the opportunity, since I'm going that way, to stop and see him. And so he and another recruiter had lunch with me in Memphis when I stopped, and I shared the gospel with him. And he looked at me, and he considered it, and I said, well, I don't know if that took or not. He didn't act like he was really interested. He didn't act like, oh, wow, I didn't know that. He didn't bite, if you will. And so I went on into my golfing adventure and came back home, and the next Sunday night, after I'd been home for a week, I got a telephone call about 7 or 8 o'clock at night, and it was another recruiter who I had had lunch with at the same time I had had lunch with the guy I witnessed to. And I really hadn't thought much about this other recruiter, but she called me, and she said, Stan, she said, I had to call you and tell you that when you were talking to the other guy, I won't call by name, when you were talking to him, she said, I was listening to what you were saying, and the next week I went to church, and I accepted Christ, and tonight I was baptized, and I wanted to call you and tell you. that your words did not fall on deaf ears, that God's message did what it was set out to accomplish. So his message is not in vain, and we should never consider the fact that we are wasting our breath witnessing to anyone. Furthermore, there is also a negative reason why witnessing is important. It's because God holds us accountable. Ezekiel chapter 3 and verse 18, it says, "When I say to a wicked man, 'You will surely die,' and you do not warn him or speak out to dissuade him from his evil ways in order to save his life, that wicked man will die in his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. But if you do warn the wicked man, and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his evil ways, he will die in his sin, but you will have saved yourself." You know, as I look and read that, this is from the Old Testament prophet Ezekiel, and he was the prophet to Israel, God's chosen people. And he tells us that the wicked will experience spiritual death. They will. And so a person who does not turn to Christ, does not turn to God for forgiveness of their sins, will experience death and hell. But the message for us is that if we fail to witness to that lost man or woman, then we will be held accountable for being disobedient to God's command to share the gospel. You see, it's a very negative thing, but I want you to know the good with the bad, because I give you the whole counsel of God. I don't try to sugarcoat it. That when we walk out of here and we just go about our life in our own merry way, because we are blessed of God, and we do not take an account, that we are charged with carrying the message of the gospel to a lost and dying world, to people in restaurants, to people in the schools, in the workplace, and our neighbors, then we are failing God, and we are being disobedient to his command. We are commanded by God to let radiate through our lives the changing effect of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Bible says to let your light shine. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 begins, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." You know, we should probably include verse 13 here as we proceed there in 14. But 13, dealing with salt, for the two, salt and light, form the complete idea of the Christian witness. One commentator says it this way: salt operates internally, preserving what it comes in contact with, while sunlight operates externally, illuminating all that it reaches. Hence, Christians are identified as the salt of the earth with reference to the masses of mankind with whom they are expected to mix, not become, but to mix with, and identified as the light of the world with reference to the vast surface that feels its radiance. That point brings out two specific things. Our light shines through our good deeds. What you do for Christ, in the name of Christ, those good deeds that, by the way, Jesus says that were established for you to do before the foundation of the world. This is what you were designed to do in Christ Jesus, good deeds. So that's the first specific thing he says. And the second one is that doing those good deeds, obeying Christ, sharing the gospel, brings praise to our Heavenly Father. Can I get an amen? You see, that's why we were created, to bring praise and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ, to God Almighty. And as we share our faith, whether it's sharing five symbols and what they mean, or it's telling somebody what God has done or is doing in your life, it brings God praise and glory. Probably the most important of all reasons to share our faith in Christ by witnessing to others is that Jesus commanded it. He commanded us to be witnesses. In Matthew 28, which we call the Great Commission, surely you are familiar with that. If not, let me share it with you. Then Jesus came to them, the disciples that is, and he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." Well, the word "make disciples" here is not just a statement, it is an imperative, and that means it is a command. He's not saying something casually, he's stating a fact for us to adhere to. You cannot make a disciple without telling a person about what Christ has done for you. That is witnessing, sharing what God's done. So we see that there's a process here. First of all, he says, go. Oh, by the way, let me explain something. In the grammatical context of the sentence, which is a simple English grammar, the subject of the sentence is you. Hello? You go. Not the preacher. It doesn't say send a preacher to tell people about Jesus and you just be a church member. It says that you are to be the one who goes and does something. What? Go, you go, and make disciples. Look at the verbs in this scripture. You go and make disciples. How do you make disciples? You tell them about Jesus, whether it's using a symbol t-shirt or a wristband or just what God has done for you. You tell them about Jesus. And when they come to Jesus, then the battle begins, because Satan is really going to be upset. Can I get a hallelujah? Some of you have recently come to Christ. Let me tell you something. Satan is going to try to upset your life. But God, through the power of the Holy Spirit living in you now, is more powerful. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And so we are to make disciples. We are to baptize them, certainly another verb, we are to baptize them. And finally, we are to teach them everything that Jesus said. Everything that Jesus said, I want you to obey me and do this, this, and this. We are to teach people to do that. You know, someone cannot do, let's use math for an instance, someone cannot learn how to work an algebra problem unless they have a teacher to teach them the process of going through and solving an algebra problem, of which, most of all, I have forgot since I got out of school. But if they don't have a teacher, it's hard to learn, isn't it? So the command is for us to go, for us to make disciples by sharing our faith, for us to baptize them in the name of Jesus, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and finally, to teach them everything that Christ has commanded us. That is, all of the commands. We are to teach them to obey all of Christ's commands. Therefore, if I am the teacher, I should be obeying myself, should I not? And one of the problems, I've said this before, one of the problems with the church today is that we are not obeying the commands of Christ, therefore, we are reluctant to teach others to tell others that they should obey the commands of Christ. So the house cleaning needs to start at home first, amen? So Jesus commanded all believers to be a witness. Another reason witnessing should be important to us is that it's important to God. He has entrusted us with the message. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 and 20. It reads this way: "All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We employ you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." This is an awesome writing that Paul penned here to the church in Corinth. He is saying that God has given us the ministry Hello. God has given us, each of us individually, as a Christian, the ministry of reconciliation. In other words, we are to be the ministers, the go-out people, the people who explain to others the ministry of reconciliation. That in Christ, a sinner can be reconciled or reinstated in right relationship to God. Hallelujah. All through Jesus. And that message, that responsibility of sharing that, has been laid in your lap and my lap. We are the ones who are the mouthpiece for Jesus today. You see, he ascended to the Father, and I'm so glad he did. Let me tell you why. Because the Bible says now that he is not sitting up there kind of watching what's going on and seeing how it's all going to play out. It says that Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father. Listen. Making intercession for the saints, that's you and me. He is looking at what's going on and seeing your life and what's happening, and he is interceding, standing in the gap, standing between you and Satan's fiery darts trying to take you out. And Jesus is interceding through prayer to the Father and saying, God, I am praying that you put a hedge around them, you keep them safe, and you protect them. And listen, we like all of that, don't we? Here's the part we back up from. And God, Jesus is praying this, and God, oh Father, equip them, empower them, that they can be witnesses until the ends of the earth. So think for a moment about the responsibility given to us to take God's message of salvation, that message of reconciliation, the message of forgiveness of our sins to the entire world. You say, Brother Stan, I can't go to the whole world. I can't go overseas. I can't go to Central America. Hello, go down your street. Go across town. Do it wherever you go. People you and I know may be going to hell because we failed to get up, get close, and get personal. And you say, well, I don't want to offend anybody. Okay, let me weigh this out. Hang in here with me a minute. I'm going to weigh this out. I don't offend them, and they go to hell. I offend them a little bit, and they come to know Jesus possibly. Now, what's it going to be? We've heard the story about how people in heaven will come up and thank us for sharing the gospel with them. You remember that song, Thank You? It's a story, and it illustrates through that song about I'm in heaven, and some people come up to me and say, wow, you didn't know me, but I heard what you said when you were telling somebody about Jesus. You didn't know me, but I saw what you wrote and left that note on the table. I was your waitress. You didn't know me, or maybe you met me casually, but what you did, what you said, how you live influenced me, and I came to Christ, and I want to thank you because I'm here. Because you shared your faith. We've all heard that story. But what about those screams from hell that we cannot hear from people whom we have failed to tell about Jesus? What about them? Yeah, we have an awesome responsibility to be a witness for Christ. And we need to be doing it here and now. Peter makes the last point about sharing our faith. He gets right up in your face with it. Always be ready to tell others about what God has done for you. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Being prepared means having made preparation beforehand. It means Bible study. It means coming to Sunday school at 9:30 instead of sleeping in the extra 45 minutes. Isn't that nice? That's some of the best sleep you'll get. The devil will have you think you are so deserving of that extra 45 minutes. This morning, I set my alarm for just after 6. Or last night I set it for just after 6. And in the middle of the night, because I normally get up at 6:30, and I said, I'm just going to get up early, and for no particular reason. And in the middle of the night, I think it was around 3 o'clock, I looked at that clock, and I said, 3 a.m., and I reached over there, and I reset the alarm for 6:30. I lost 15 minutes, but I still got here on time for Bible study. That's okay. It's when the alarm goes off, when we're supposed to be getting up, getting ready for Bible study, and we hit that snooze button. And then we hit it again, and we hit it again. I've been there. I love hitting the snooze button. But you know what? I love fellowship with Jesus and his believers even more. And so it drives me to get up and to come to Sunday school. So being prepared means having made preparation. It means knowing experientially the hope that is in you. In other words, I know about the hope because I've experienced the hope that Jesus Christ brings. Always be ready, looking for God's open door of opportunity to make that difference in someone's life, a forever difference. Lastly, and of mega importance, Christians are enabled to spread the gospel. And this brings us to our focus text, Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Christ never commands us to do anything he does not equip us or empower us to do. He says in this scripture, you will receive power. Well, you did when you were saved. May I remind you, when you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, he gave you his Holy Spirit to live in you and reside with you forever. So you have been empowered. And it says, you will be my witnesses. He doesn't say some of you will be my witnesses, but all of you who are in Christ will be my witnesses. You know, someone told me one time, Brother Stan, we're all witnesses. I said, really? He says, yeah, some are just not very good at it. They're not very good witnesses. People look at their lives and they scratch their head and say, that's a Christian? Hello. We can do as much damage to the kingdom as we can do good. Amen? So we need to remember we are a witness. The question is, are we doing a good job at it? By giving us the Holy Spirit, he gives us the means to accomplish this command. He tells us what we are to do, spread the gospel, and he tells us where we're to do it, to the ends of the earth. And we have the how, we have the what, we have the where. So what excuse is it do we have for not obeying what God said to do? I don't believe we have any excuse. So let me draw the string tight on this lesson this morning. There is no reason why Christians should not share their faith with everyone. Are you afraid that someone's going to get offended? Hello, we're talking about this little child walking out to the street where the highway is, and you happen to look and see the little toddler heading for the highway where the cars are going back and forth, and you're thinking, oh my God, he could be killed. He could lose his life. And so you scream, stop. You grab him. You snatch him away from the danger. How much more important is it for us to get somebody's attention in the world that is headed for hell, that is headed for destruction, not just for a moment, but for all eternity? How important is it that we snatch them out of the way? Oh, I don't want to offend them. We need to be politically correct. Well, as Sean DePeer said, there's a lot of people going to hell in a handbasket because of us not sharing our faith. We are a privileged people to live in a free country where we can. We can expect results when we do. We are accountable to God if we don't. We are commanded by Christ to do it. He trusted us with his message. And finally, he empowered us to be his witnesses to all the world. Would you stand with me as we pray?